it just completely took the crowd out of it. That's how we get it done on the road. And time out of the court time as we send you over to Doris Brooks from the sun. Doris?
Nice job.
Well, once again, you find yourself with a points and rebounds double-double. Is that something you come to expect from yourself on a nightly basis? Thank you for your time. This one far from over, Kevin.
Doris, thank you as always. And that about wraps it up for Clark, Greg, and Doris, and the rest of our terrific crew. This is Kevin Harlan saying thanks for watching. And now we'll head over to the studio with Ernie Johnson, the 2K Sports hosted show. Thank you, Kevin. And now we get a chance to present our Jordan player of the game, Frank. He had an outstanding third quarter. Whatever they needed in terms of energy and offense, he was the firepower that propelled them during the second half.
All right, that is the definition of domination. He took them to school tonight in every possible way. I know they had 10 players on the court, but I only know this one.
Seeing a freak dominate the way he did tonight reminded me of watching him play in high school. He was a man among boys. He was a four-time consensus All-American back then. Overall, it's pretty good.
And that'll do it for tonight. For Kenny Smith, Shaquille O'Neal, Kevin Harlan, and our illustrious 2K Sports crew, this is Ernie Johnson. Have a good night, everybody.
Presidential candidate, Dr. Jill Stein.
All right, great to have you here. First, let me lay out the ground rules for this town hall and how we're going to conduct this, and then we'll get started. So we asked you guys for questions, and boy, did you give us questions. So a ton of them came in. We've got some great ones here. My role here is to ask follow-ups. The questions will come largely from the audience at home, some in the form of videos, including from our TYT Network partners on YouTube, and also from the audience here at YouTube Space LA. And I want to thank YouTube Space LA for hosting us here, and I want to thank the Young Turks members for making all of this possible, tytnetwork.com/join, of course. And here's the interesting part of how we're going to do things a little differently. You guys are allowed to react. Okay. Thank you.
And of course, what we're trying to determine here is, with less than 3 weeks to go, who are you going to vote for? And so it's great to have Dr. Stein here to help us understand her positions more fully. And you guys have asked some great policy questions, so I want to get to it. First of all, Dr. Stein, thank you for being here. I know you basically just got out of the hospital. So a real trooper here. Are you okay?
Wild horses couldn't keep me away.
It wasn't the same pneumonia as Hillary Clinton, right?
Well, I don't know. There may be a new thing called female candidate pneumonia.
All right. I'm going to leave the Trump joke out. All right, so let's get started. I want to start with Matt Foreman, who wrote in with this question. I don't think you're going to be surprised given what happened on Sunday. What did HBO comedian John Oliver get wrong about your plan to cancel student debt?
What he got wrong, quite simply, was that student debt is eminently cancelable. If we could bail out Wall Street to the tune of $16 trillion, the crooks who crashed the economy through their waste, fraud, and abuse, it's about time we bailed out the victims of that waste, fraud, and abuse, our younger generation. There are many ways that we can do that. In fact, their office had, John Oliver's producers had called us, and we made it very clear that there are many ways we can do this. One way is through this fancy thing called quantitative easing, which is controversial, but there are many other ways. Instead of paying for an entirely new generation of nuclear weapons, which costs about as much as student debt, how about instead we cancel those nuclear weapons and instead we pay for a generation of young people that deserve to be unleashed from these chains of endless debt. So quite simply, there are many ways that this can be done. And I would just say to John Oliver, are you part of the Hillary Clinton Protection Network? There are a lot of jokes that could be made about Hillary Clinton, but I don't see them coming from John Oliver's show.
Alfredo Alvarez also wrote in basically a follow-up to this question. He said, can you go into detail on how you plan to cancel student debt, which you partly did there, including which departments would be involved, how you would deal with any adverse effects on the economy caused by eliminating over $1 trillion in debt?
Actually, it would be the stimulus package of our dreams. So, it's not so much having the technical details here of the plan as it is having the actual intention to do it. The weak link here is not having an ad nauseum detailed plan. You know, these plans get ripped up all the time. The critical issue is the people of America or whether they are serving their financial overlords and their corporate sponsors. So, getting rid of $1 trillion worth of debt means that instead that money is actually going into the economy. It means that an entire generation of young people, instead of working part-time, low-wage, temporary jobs that lead to nowhere, instead they actually get released to do what it is they've been trained for, what they have their degrees in, where their passion is. Every generation has to lead the way forward to the economy of the future, and we badly need to liberate that generation to lead the way forward now.
But Alfredo... Does have a really good question in that, and I really want to just go into it just a little bit more there. So I want to understand the mechanics behind it. So folks took out loans to go to school, and when we cancel it, does that mean that we are going to the banks and basically paying off those loans?
So the language we use actually is bailout, so that the most likely way to do this is through Congress. And how does Congress decide to do that? That's because if we had an organizer in chief in the White House, we would actually have the offices of our congressmen and women overflowing with passionate people who are instructing our representatives how to represent us. So the bottom line is that Congress appropriates that money, which would be about $1 trillion, a little bit more than that, and it could be over a period of 2 or 3 years. And that money basically is used to pay off that debt. So that, in other words, Congress purchases that debt as an investment in our most valued resource, our younger generation.
So it's not like the banks who have the loans don't get paid. They
That's
do
right.
get paid, but they
That's
get paid
right.
by the Treasury.
That's right.
The
exactly.
quantitative easing would involve the Fed. That would be a
That's
different
right.
route altogether.
That would be a very different route, where, in which the Fed would basically digitally create money,
mm-hmm.
which is what the Fed did in order to bail out Wall Street.
Mm-hmm.
The Fed could digitally create that money in order to buy the loans that the students have. And then the Fed could choose to consider that an investment in our future as well. That is much more controversial. Jeremy Corbyn calls this people's quantitative easing, and that's what it would be. It would be the Fed creating money on behalf of the American people instead of creating money digitally on behalf of bailing out the banks, for example.
Since there's been a lot of questions about that, I'm just going to do one last follow-up on the quantitative easing part. So when the Fed does that for banks, you're right, they digitally create money, and then but they buy the bank's assets, which theoretically they could later sell, although that is a bizarre situation, and I'm not sure they've ever sold any of those assets. In this case, they would be buying the loans that the students have, that they're buying it from the banks.
That's right.
But then they would presumably never sell them, which
exactly.
would be different than
That's
the
right.
bank situation where they could sell them.
And my understanding is that the banks actually did repay those loans because banks are set up to be able to do that. They're loaned money at virtually zero interest rates, and they just turn right around and they loan it out at 7 or 10% or whatever they decide. So they are eminently enabled by our financial system to generate money out of thin air, really, and out of consumer debt. That's what they do. But that system's not working for us. And actually, the Constitution gives the American government the power to create that money. That power was turned over to the Fed in the early 1900s. Abraham Lincoln used that power in order to create the greenback, which is how the Civil War was fought, on the basis of that federally created money. So, you know, if we really want to go into the policy wonk details, it's fascinating, and there's a lot of room that in which we could explore this. But, you know, for the purposes of a town hall forum and a political campaign, that's really, you know, it's not the time to be educating, but it's definitely a discussion that is long overdue and that we, the American people, need to think about. Who is it that controls our currency, and who should be in charge?
Yes.
That's actually,
the only part I'll disagree with is that's actually why we do the town halls, because I think it is really instructive. I think that it's interesting that the mainstream media hasn't asked the two so-called major candidates, no, to be fair, they are the major candidates, they're leading the polls now, about do they support the Federal Reserve digitally creating money in terms of quantitative easing. That's never been asked.
Yeah.
And so I haven't seen any satirical pieces on that, on, hey, why are we digitally creating money? Why are we buying these assets? What are we going to do with these assets? So I think that third parties actually create a situation where we begin to ask those interesting questions. So I'm glad that we dove into it. But now let's move on to the next topic. So this one, we've got a video from Scott Boylan, and he wanted to ask you about the military.
With the Department of Defense spending $47 million to build a $500,000 gas station in Afghanistan, and the U.S. Army not being able to account for over $6 trillion in spending, is it negligence or is it corruption? Also, what do you plan to do to assure that our tax monies are spent correctly and also efficiently to achieve our goals?
So I didn't catch one critical word. Is it something or is it corruption?
Yeah, so he said, is it just being inefficient, basically,
mm-hmm.
or do you think it's actual corruption?
It's hard to know how we would sort that out, you know, when the Pentagon is essentially unaccountable. But there's no doubt that our system is unofficially corrupted, if not officially corrupted. And by that, what I mean is that, you know, as President Eisenhower had warned us about the power of the military, industrial, congressional, Congress to buy policy and determine policy, that's clearly, you know, what's going on. And enormous amounts of money are contributed not only to Congress, but also to the major presidential candidates. And, you know, they are constantly fulfilling the needs of the war profiteers to gin up enemies and to create wars in order to maintain this budget. And in terms of efficiency in our budget, you know, there are many areas where efficiency can be brought to bear. But just focusing on the military, that is the biggest one. It's more than half of our discretionary budget. It's almost half of your income taxes right now that go to this bloated military. It's not a Department of Defense. It's a Department of Offense. And what is its track record? It's creating, it is creating failed states, mass refugee migration, and worse terrorist threats. According to a Harvard study recently, we've spent $6 trillion on Iraq and Afghanistan alone by the time you include the ongoing health care costs of our wounded soldiers. That's the least we can do for them, and we should be doing much more for them. But the point is that $6 trillion, and you know, it's basically gone up in smoke. So there are very, very different ways forward. We're calling for a peace offensive in the Middle East, and for a foreign policy based on international law, human rights, and diplomacy, and cutting our military budget so that it's truly a defense department, not an offense department.
Ronald Wolf also sent in a question on this topic, and I think it serves as a good follow-up to Scott's question. How would you scale down the Pentagon budget and control corrupt contracting practices while convincing Americans, our allies, and others that we are prepared to defend ourselves if necessary?
Great. So, you know, one way that we scale things down is, you know, we have a pay-to-play rule, you know. And not only do we scale down the size of the budget, but we also scale down the influence peddling in that budget, you know. If the rules of the game eliminated those who are buying influence from actually capturing those contracts, then, you know, we would see a very different Department of Defense. That's one way to weed it out. Another way to weed it out is let's just put an end to the revolving door so that people are not moving from the industries into the Department of Defense, you know, or into other areas that determine the contracting. So it's not so much how do we do this, you know. In my view, how we do this is by building a strong political alternative that demands that there's a different way forward. And in terms of convincing people that it's safe, you know, I'd say let's start by having a public discussion. Why is it that the Democrats and Republicans insisted, you know, on silencing political opposition? Because they know that their proposals do not stand up to the light of day, that these policies of endless militarism, we've been at war in Afghanistan now for 16 years. Every war we have conducted as part of this cycle of war on terror, everyone has been a shocking failure. Every so-called terrorist entity that we've been fighting has only gotten stronger, has conquered more territory, has been turned into a global movement. This this strategy of brute military force is a massive and catastrophic failure. It needs to have the light of day shined on it, and people need to know that there is another way forward. And that begins with a weapons embargo on the Middle East, since we are the major supplier of weapons to parties on all sides. We can begin this embargo quite effectively. I believe we could bring the Russians on board because they too are struggling to handle the costs of their military budget. They too are struggling with the consequences of unbridled terrorist extremism. That blows back at them equally. So there's a very different path forward here. It starts with a weapons embargo, and then it moves to freezing the bank accounts of those countries who insist on funding terrorism. And the recent email leaks revealed that Hillary Clinton is well aware that the leading funder is none other than our good ally, Saudi Arabia. So we need to get clear with Saudi Arabia that we cannot simultaneously, with one hand, fight terrorism, while with the other hand, we and our allies are funding terrorism, training terrorism, and arming terrorism. We have to decide which way we go.
So now let's get really into the nitty-gritty of this issue, because in this area, because I think it's really important for people to know where you stand. So I'm sure that some would say, well, look, if you do that with Saudi Arabia, you're going to endanger our alliance with them. And if you do, there will be some consequences. And maybe we can live with those consequences. But one of them is likely the price of oil will go up. Because it appears that the deal we've made with the Saudis is, you go do whatever you're going to do, but you keep OPEC under control and make sure that our gas prices aren't that high. Are you willing to say to the American people, yes, your gas prices might go up, but we need to do this deal?
Well, as a matter of fact, you know, if that were the issue, gas prices going up, simply the savings on our military budget, which remember, is draining more than half of our discretionary budget, we have more than enough money to help subsidize that price of oil and ensure that there's not a significant rise. And the companion, actually, to our foreign policy is this call for an emergency green energy jobs program. So that we are becoming independent not only of fossil fuel from Saudi Arabia, which is currently a rather small part of the mix. We could make that up from Venezuela, for example, you know, who needs a market for their oil. And I'll bet they'd be willing to sell it to us really cheap. So there are many options here. The point is, you know, that these options should be defined by elected officials who are responsive to we the people, who do not owe their their return favors to the fossil fuel industry, to the predatory banks, and to the war profiteers who are currently calling the shots.
So let's dive into the issue of Russia there then, because you brought that up obviously in Syria, it's very relevant. Right now it appears that the Russians are helping the Syrian government pretty much decimate Aleppo. So I assume you're concerned about that. How do you deal with the Russians and try to persuade them to not do that?
It's important that we stop beating the war drum around Russia, which long preceded Syria. So, you know, we have sort of forced Russia into a very defensive posture. And you may recall that at the time that Germany was reunified, the promise was made to Gorbachev, the leader of the Soviet Union, that NATO would not move one inch to the east of Berlin. Well, since then, NATO has been steadily moving to essentially surround Russia. Now we're conducting war games around Russia. We are dropping fake nuclear weapons in Nevada, preparing for this potential nuclear war, which Hillary Clinton is begging to start. And let's just be clear what it is that Hillary Clinton's policy on Russia is. It is essentially a virtual declaration of war. That is what will happen if Hillary Clinton proceeds with her plan to create a no-fly zone. That means we are shooting down Russian aircraft over Syria. So in my view, Zbigniew Brzezinski, who used to be the main proponent of U.S. domination of the Middle East and Asia, he's kind of like the original neocon. He has changed his tune after decades of advising presidents. He's now changed his tune to say the future, the 21st century, is not about tough guy, bully in the schoolyard domination. It's actually about collaboration, and that we need to begin working out our common interests with Russia as well as with China and developing a collaborative way forward. As horrible as Aleppo is, let's just remember that there was a ceasefire which the U.S. broke by bombing forces which were not moving around. They had been stationary there for quite some time. So it was really perceived as our intentional disruption of this ceasefire. This is not to say that we are the bad guys here, but rather that there are no bad guys and there are no good guys. We need to enter into dialogue here as part of the community of nations. There are many areas where we need to collaborate with Russia, not only to stop the disaster in Syria, but also on nuclear weapons and on climate change. These are incredible catastrophic threats to us all. If we had honest brokers rather than tools of the defense industry who were negotiating, and this is not to impugn John Kerry, because I think he's done a pretty reasonable job given the tools that he's been handed, but I think we could be handing our Secretary of State far better tools to work with. We could have a much more collaborative position with Russia.
So, I think that everyone is clear that you would be on a much less war footing than the, either the Democrats or the Republicans. You want to roll that back. You think it's been counterproductive, as you've clearly explained here. What I want to understand is the parameters, Dr. Stein, of where you would use force. So let's take an example. In Syria, let's say we've got your intelligence officials come in, you're the president, and they say, we have Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. Can we do a drone strike to kill him? What would you say?
Well, in my view, you know, you may remember that Israel at one point got their hands on Adolf Eichmann, who had murdered 6 million Jews. They could have thought, wow, we got to get this guy. This is like the world's worst guy ever. We got to take him out. They did not take him out. They complied with international law. They captured him. They brought him through the agony of a trial, and he paid the ultimate price. In doing so, we upheld a system of international law. Either we are a world of laws or we are a world of bullies. Which is it going to be? I think we need to set the right example, and you know, we need to go forward. Where I would use force is where international law allows us to use force, which is when we ourselves are under imminent threat of attack, or we actually are under attack.
So just to be clear here, you would not do this drone strike on Baghdadi. Would you have special forces go in to try to extract them, as they kind of did with bin Laden before they executed him, as they did in Somalia with a warlord there? Or no, you're not going to send in special forces or the strike?
No, I think, you know, special forces are an acceptable option, you know, in a policing action. That is different, you know, from a violation of international law or an act of war. You know, I think we need to uphold international law if we want to have a world that we can all live in.
So if there was a judgment against al-Baghdadi in an international tribunal, then you could send in special forces to, in essence, arrest them? I'm asking. I don't know.
So, you know, technically I haven't looked at those rules, but if those indeed are internationally respected rules, then yes.
Okay.
But, you know, drone strikes are an assassination program, and we know that they are wrong 9 times out of 10. And we also know that where drones have been used, they have been extremely effective in mobilizing the local population against us and becoming a recruiting tool for the very forces that we claim to be fighting. So, no, I would not use drones as a weapon of war. It is not a surgical strike. It is a highly effective way to mobilize people against us.
One last question about Iraq and Syria. If our allies in Baghdad say, hey, these guys have not only taken Mosul and all the cities that they have, they're advancing on Baghdad. We really, really need your help. What would be your response?
You know, I think this is why you don't want to get into sort of that kind of brinksmanship situation. This is why I think we need to act now, and we need to act now to engage a weapons embargo so that we have not only the U.S., but we also have the Russians and our allied forces. You know, so much of ISIS's success now has been in part supported and fostered by our allies. We need to cut that means of support, the care and feeding of terrorist forces that is going on by the Saudis through their supply of weapons, through their funding, and through their training. This is why we need to cut it off now, because, you know, we might be able to hold Baghdad for weeks or even a year, but what the past 16 years has shown is that everywhere that we have won a victory, that victory has been reversed. You know, we've seen Aleppo change hands 5 or 6 times, the same with Mosul. You know, so are we going to just blindly continue this cycle that only creates worse violence? It's not only that this fails, it's that it creates the next generation of violence and terror. We only dig ourselves in deeper.
All right, and one last question on foreign policy in this regard. If the Russians cross into Estonia and there are rumblings where they say, well, there is a Russian minority within Estonia that needs to be protected. If they cross the border with Estonia, how would you react?
Well, this is why I would want to have a open line of communication with the Russians starting now, so that we ensure that that does not happen. And we're begging for that to happen by creating this sense of brinksmanship, by surrounding Russia with our nuclear weapons, with our missiles, and our troops with NATO. Consider this. This is like the Cuban Missile Crisis in reverse, on steroids. Plus, the Russians have also sent their troops now, you know, thinking back to the Cuban Missile Crisis, they now have their troops along the Mexican border or the Canadian border. We would be going ballistic. So we need to start diffusing the situation right now and not wait until we're on the brink of a disaster.
Right, but you have questioned our NATO alliance before. So I understand what you're saying about your long-term plan, but right now, as they're watching this, you know, across the world, if you become president, can Estonia be sure as a member of NATO that the U.S. would protect them?
Well, while we are a member of NATO, we are obliged by our treaty contracts. But, you know, I'll say that Andrew Bacevich, who was a high-ranking military officer, now a military historian, his argument is that let's let NATO take care of Europe. Remember, NATO was formed during the Cold War, and it had its counterpart in the Warsaw Pact. The Warsaw Pact no longer exists, nor does the Soviet Union. This is essentially a war budget in search of funding. We need a very different way forward. We need to explore how we can create a truly defensible U.S. foreign policy, not one that is creating catastrophic situations and robbing us, the American people, blind. And let me add one more thing. The $6 trillion that the Harvard study said we are paying for Afghanistan and Iraq, that $6 trillion comes down to $50,000 for everybody's household out there. You're all putting $50,000 just to pay off our current obligations on Iraq and Afghanistan. $50,000 per household. Is that something you would have chosen to do? I think a lot of people would have chosen otherwise. The discussion needs to be put in those terms. Are we going to have an endless and bottomless military budget that pays for endless catastrophic war? I don't think that's what the American people want.
I think that's near the average salary of an American worker.
Mm-hmm.
A year's salary for the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. It's an interesting question for the audience at home on whether they would have approved that if they had known that. Okay, so now let's move on to energy. Nelson Amaya writes in, how do you plan on switching the United States from oil and coal-based energy to more renewable energy? Do you plan on gradually moving to more renewable sources or switching over quickly? And what will happen to the workers in the coal and oil industries?
Wonderful question, and that gets down really to the heart of the matter. We need an emergency transition because we have an emergency with the climate, and we also have an emergency with the economy. And actually, the oil and coal workers are in the middle of that emergency already because the price of oil has gone down, because the price of fracking has gone down, that is natural gas, and because their health, their very survival is very much in the target hairs. When you walk into a job in the fossil fuel industry, your risk of dying actually goes up by 700% the moment you walk in the door. And that's just from acute injuries. That is from explosions, from fires, from equipment crashes, from motor vehicle accidents. So it's a very dangerous kind of job. And in my experience talking to these workers, they are hungrier than anybody for a different option, one that is good for them and good for their communities and good for the planet. They have just been put in this very uncomfortable position of being really intimidated into thinking that's the only kind of job that you can have. So the bottom line is, We need an emergency jobs program that will also solve the emergency of the climate crisis. It's not so complicated. We did this during the Great Depression in our New Deal, which created jobs. Now we need jobs on an emergency basis that will transition our economy to 100% clean renewable energy by 2030. Not the end of the century, but in real time. And we also call for transitioning our food system as well, which is a major contributor to greenhouse gases and the climate crisis, and also calling for public transportation, renewably powered and energy efficient, as well as restoring our ecosystems. So the bottom line is, there is a job for everyone. This is truly an emergency. That's what the science is telling us. So this is an all-hands-on-deck situation. When Pearl Harbor was bombed at the outset of the Second World War, it took us 6 months, all of 6 months, to totally transform the economy to 25% of GDP based on the wartime effort. So if we could do that in 6 months, we can meet the emergency of climate change within the next 15 years, which is what we call for. And we call for the workers in the fossil fuel industry, as well as the communities that depend on that income, to be assured that they get the job. They are front and center in having that job at equivalent pay with equivalent benefits.
So let's get into the details there just a little bit more. So I understand the long-term plan. I think you explained it very well. I think they all understand it. In the short term, when it comes time, whenever that might be, would you physically actually shut down the coal mines and tell the coal companies, for example, that's it, you're not allowed to do this, you're not allowed to do this anymore?
So here's what the science tells us, and there was a report from Oil Change International about 2 weeks ago that said we have 17 years, folks. We need to zero out fossil fuels by then. And that's roughly the time frame that we've been calling for, by 2030, to have zeroed out the fossil fuels. But that means, you know, that doesn't mean shutting down those jobs alone. That means on an emergency basis, it means putting people to work in the healthy equivalent jobs, creating solar energy and wind towers and public transportation, rapid rail and light rail and so on. So yes, it means we need to do that. So, you know, that's what it's not like we have a choice. It's like either we do that or it's curtains, potentially within a matter of decades. And that's what the science is telling us now. Jim Hansen, who hasn't been wrong yet, his latest study says as soon as 2060, and others, you know, say even 2050, that we are looking at 10, 20, 30 feet of sea level rise, which will be absolutely catastrophic. Let's not make bones about it. This is goodbye Manhattan. This is goodbye Florida. This is goodbye coastal population centers in the U.S. and all over the world. So, you know, this is utter chaos and catastrophe, not to mention some 16 or so nuclear power plants located on the coast that are all going Fukushima. So get ready not just for flooding, but for incredibly toxic flooding as we flood out our nuclear power, our oil refineries, our LNG plants, etc. This is not a crisis we want to deal with. So we need to do this. We can do this in a way that creates the jobs. The obvious question, where does the money come from? So those who spend a lifetime on this say that it would be approximately $500 billion to get this program up and running, and that's to create 20 million of these good wage jobs. And so that's $500 billion, which is essential for our survival. How we come up with that? Again, by having an organizer in the White House so that we flood the offices of our elected representatives and ensure that instead of investing $1 trillion a year in a bloated military-industrial security complex that's not making us safer, instead, we spend a good portion of that money actually creating the Green New Deal. Or that we tax Wall Street. A tiny transaction tax of 0.2% would be creating almost $400 billion, practically enough to pay for the Green New Deal right then and there.
Okay, so I understand your analysis of where the money comes from. Let me just be perfectly clear, though, and some Northern European countries have done this, saying you're not allowed to have coal mines anymore in our countries, or they've passed laws or proposed laws in that direction. So would you say no more coal mining in America, no more oil drilling in America?
Well, unfortunately, you know, I wish we could negotiate with the science, but science doesn't negotiate, and neither does the climate. It doesn't, you know, like backpedal a little bit because you don't like the results, or because the fossil fuel-sponsored politicians, you know, have an industry to protect. You know, there's just as many jobs to be created. In fact, there are far more jobs to be created by doing what the science tells us we must do. The science is perfectly clear. We must zero out fossil fuel. Zero means zero. By 2030, maybe give or take a year or two, but even, you know, most scientists would say we are really playing with fire not to have already embarked on this and to be well on our way right now. You know, the EPA has the authority to protect our environment and to protect our health that depends on the environment. Since when is human extinction compatible with human health? It's not. In my view, it's within the purview of the Environmental Protection Agency to ensure that humanity does not go extinct. That means the EPA needs to be a part of this emergency transition as well.
All right, great. Now, we're going to take a really quick two-minute break here, and we're going to come back, and we're going to follow up with the issue of money and politics, and, of course, the question everybody's asking, spoiler, candidate or not, but there's been a very interesting way of putting it, scented by someone in the audience, and many other issues to come. So we'll be right back.
Good night, good luck.
Rick Santorum and Jeb Bush, come up a little bit short.
Please clap.
The boy behind me has exited.
Down goes Cruz!
These are the two most unpopular candidates we have ever had in our nation's history.
Jesus Christ, there is significant booze every time Hillary Clinton's name is mentioned. This is amazing.
We're kind of hardened because we've been to many, many Trump events and we've seen some shit.
What happened to your right?
They've been taken away by Obama!
Wow! So wonderfully sad!
It was Chris, it looked like he was looking at Donald Trump's hair like it was cotton candy.
You're fucking, you know about it.
Don't talk to me like that.
Anything can happen on election night on the
Untruth. That's the only time on this show. What else are you going to want?
You don't want to miss any of this ever. Presidential candidate, of course. Dr. Stein, thank you for being here. We have someone in the audience here now who wants to ask you a question. John, what do we have?
This is a question from Justin Brown.
Hi, just then. Terrific question. So let me start with the piece about, you know, how will we deal with a Congress that doesn't get anything done in the first place and now has, you know, an insurgent president that stands for the opposite of what they got elected to do. So let me say that, you know, if we were to turn the White House into a greenhouse, this would make the world a safer place. It would be a whole new ball game. And let me also say that this isn't like a totally far-fetched and outrageous thing to do. The political house of cards is falling down. They've created a media blackout because they know that this is a very dangerous moment for the political establishment. 76% of voters were clamoring for an open debate. We know that these are the most disliked and untrusted candidates ever in our history, and that even their own supporters don't really support them. They're mostly deathly afraid of the other candidate. You know, so this is a house of cards in the process of falling down. The only question is, when is it going to happen? And from my point of view, the more organized we are, the quicker we will make this life-saving, civilization-saving transition happen. Now, let's just say word got out that student debt could actually be ended, that we could, in fact, create a bailout. There are 43 million young people right now who are held hostage in student debt with no way out in the foreseeable future. That is a winning plurality of the vote. If that word got out, enough people could actually turn out and not split the vote, but flip the vote. So I just want to lay out that it's not so far-fetched to think that we could actually have a democracy, that people could actually be informed that they have real choices out there. So let's imagine that there's a groundswell, and we find ourselves, we the people, for the first time in history, we have an organizer in chief. Well, remember, you know, right now, who is it that's calling the shots in Congress? It is the lobbyists. You know, if you didn't know that from just common sense, you could read any of the major studies out there, like the Gillens and Page out of Northwestern and Princeton, yada-da, that document that public opinion has almost a zero relationship to the agenda on Congress. They are busy doing the work of the predatory banks, etc. That's what they do. So if we had, they can do that because we, the public, are locked out. We don't know what's going on, very little. You know, it comes to us in dribs and drabs through the corporate media. So there's not kind of an organizing strategy out there to coordinate the vast numbers of people that could be mobilized to end student debt, to pass health care as a human right, which, by the way, doesn't cost us anymore under Medicare for All. It just means we put healthcare dollars into healthcare, not into profiteering and bureaucracy and red tape. So, in my view, this agenda is eminently doable if we the people are mobilized and we are flooding the offices of our representatives and insisting, you know, so that there's kind of an organizing plan by the week. It's, hey, folks, here comes the bill to pass the Green New Deal. We need you to flood your elected, you know, your reps' offices, your senators' offices with emails, phone calls, and show up if you can. We've done this before, like to stop the privatization of the internet. We've done this before to stop the 2013 bombing campaign of Syria. what they tell us, you know, they tell us resistance is futile because they are quaking in their boots that we should discover how much power we have when we are organized. And that is the key. And in my view, that's how we win this election. Whether we're in the White House or we win the day by becoming that organized, unstoppable political power that we can be. In the words of Alice Walker, biggest way we give up power is by not knowing we have it to start with. It's time for us to know that we have it and to start organizing like we have it.
Thank you, Dustin. That leads fairly naturally into Mira Luna's question. She asks, between the campaign finance system, the economy, lobbyists, and their revolving doors, and our so-called democracy, the system seems rigged. How do you propose we change our government? It seems impossible to overcome.
Well, let me say, in Massachusetts, in my home state, we actually passed campaign finance reform. We actually got the big money out of politics. We created public financing, and we did it through a voter referendum because the legislature, 85% Democratic, refused to pass this bill. You know, they wouldn't touch it with a 10-foot pole. We, the people, got out a referendum. We passed it by an overwhelming majority. It was not hard to do. And once you begin public financing, then suddenly all the money in the world doesn't, you know, it can't buy the election because then money is no longer in control. And a companion to this, by the way, should be freeing the media so that corporations no longer hold our public airwaves hostage to their profiteering. Doing those two things, we actually re-engage the wheels of democracy. It's not rocket science. I should mention, what happened when we passed public financing in Massachusetts was that the Democratic legislature repealed it on a voice vote. They stopped public financing because they did not want to have to run against real candidates with a politics of integrity. Not only did they, can public financing, but they also refused to pass ranked choice voting, which is the other critical solution here. That's how they keep you locked in fear by always having a worser evil that makes them, the inevitable, the candidate you have to support because you're terrified of something worse. Bottom line is, we can get out of this trap, but we have to do it ourselves. They are not going to hand us democracy on a silver platter. That's why it's so critical for us to reject this propaganda that tells us we are powerless. We are not powerless, we are powerful, and we actually have the numbers that we could turn this election on its head. By standing up against the power of money, we can mobilize the public will and enact the no-brainer solutions that are there within our reach to put an end to the revolving door, put an end to money in politics, and put an end to the stranglehold that the corporate media has over our democracy.
So let me go quickly then. A couple of big questions on that issue. Are you in favor of a constitutional amendment to get money out of politics?
Absolutely.
What would that amendment say in your ideal world? What would it address?
Quite simply, that Citizens United wasn't the only problem. Money in politics was firmly entrenched before then because of the Supreme Court, a series of decisions that really misinterpreted the Constitution, massively distorted it. We need to clarify beyond any shadow of a doubt that money is not speech, because these rulings are based on this outrageous idea that money is the equivalent of speech. If that were true, then, you know, the richer you are, the more you are entitled to free speech, and that, 50% of the American population, you might as well just forget it right now, that it's $1 one vote, it's not one person one vote. What this amendment needs to say is that money is not speech, corporations are not people, and that we, the American people, have the right to democratically decide our future.
Hillary Clinton
Hillary Clinton also says that she's in favor of a constitutional amendment and will propose in the first 30 days. Do you believe her?
Well, what Hillary Clinton says is that we need to get unaccountable money out of politics. That's all she actually pretends to support. Unaccountable money? You know, what exactly is that? You know, it's like, I think she's talking about dark money. But that makes it perfectly okay as long as, you know, as long as the money is declared. You know, so it's like saying our politicians can belong to corporations, they just have to wear the corporate logos on their sweaters. You know, that's not okay. Democracy belongs to us, not to the big corporations that are running us over the cliff.
All right. Now, next, we go to Kerryon VC's student, and the question is, when I tell people that I will vote for Jill Stein, I often hear, it's a wasted vote. You're voting for Trump. She has no chance to win. Polls show that the majority of your supporters come from potential Hillary Clinton voters. What do you say to convince people who don't want a Donald Trump presidency to vote for you instead of Hillary Clinton?
So, polls also say that 4 out of 10 American voters will not vote, given the choices of Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton. So, you know, what I would say is, are we saying that 4 out of 10 American voters, those who are being thrown under the bus, which is, it may be 4 out of 10 today, it will be 6 out of 10 tomorrow, it will be 8 out of 10 after that, you know, we need to stand up. You know, we need to stand up for our democracy. It's like, what exactly is the exit strategy here? Because it is a race to the bottom between the greater and the lesser evil. It's not only the terrible things that Donald Trump says, it's the awful things that Hillary Clinton actually does. It's not... There could be no more catastrophic wars out there than what she already single-handedly led the charge for in Libya. It's not acceptable to be bombing millions of Muslims and say that, oh no, Donald Trump, you cannot ban Muslims, but I, Hillary Clinton, you know, I bombed Muslims. That's not okay either. Hillary Clinton, you know, is part of the Democratic Party's immigration policy, which has already done unfathomable human rights violations to immigrants. 3 million have been deported under this White House, and Hillary Clinton has been a part of that. In fact, she gave the thumbs up to the military coup in Honduras, which has led to the refugees, tens of thousands, pouring into this country, and Hillary Clinton saying, no, bar the gates, send those dangerous children back. That is unacceptable. The Republicans may be the party of hate and fear. The Democrats are the party of detention, deportation, and night raids. This is a race to the bottom between the greater evil and the lesser evil. And if we can't stand up now, remember, with each election, they both get worse. The Democrats, like the Republicans, become more corporatist, more militarist, and more imperialist. If we cannot begin to pull up now, when exactly are we going to interrupt this downward spiral? It's up to us. And remember, while Donald Trump's scumbag predator misogyny is creating a smokescreen right now, there are plans in the works for economic predators to win the day once Hillary Clinton wins the election. That is for Social Security to be privatized, and that is also for additional, well, all sorts of stuff. But in particular, there's another really bad one that I am not thinking of at the moment, but it will come to me. The point is that under Clinton, with Clinton's support, under Bill, with Hillary's support, we got NAFTA exporting our jobs. We got the Wall Street meltdown with deregulation. Hillary Clinton has long been a servant for Wall Street, and she has said that, she's told Wall Street that they should be able to regulate themselves, that Dodd-Frank was just for show. Frank was just for show. So, you know, she's been a big fan of the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Bottom line here is, Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me 2, 3, 4, 10, 20 times, shame on me. It's time for us, we the people, to stand up with the power that we have and reject the lesser evil, fight for the greater good, like our lives depend on it, because they do. We have the power to create the world we deserve.
I'm going to ask you a hypothetical here, and I understand if you don't want to answer because you're running against them, but I am intensely curious, so I'm going to ask it. If you and Gary Johnson and no one else is allowed into the race, and somebody says, you, Jill Stein, will pick between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump as to who will be president, who would you pick?
You know, to my mind, the differences between them are not enough to save your job, to save your life, or to save the planet. We live in a democracy, and we have more than two deadly choices. In this election, we're not just deciding what kind of world we will have, but whether we will have a world or not going forward, in terms of the climate, in terms of endless and expanding war, in terms of the nuclear catastrophe that we are teetering on the brink of right now. I will not sleep well if Donald Trump is elected, but I will not knowing that we could slip into World War III going nuclear at any moment, because Hillary has already effectively declared war on Russia. So I think this is not acceptable. We live in a democracy. Let's not allow them to make us forget that. We, the people, have the power. It's time for us to stand up and build that world that we deserve that is within our reach.
All right, we're going to go to a video. Todd Valesky is the host of Secular Talk and the TYT Network, and he had a policy question for you as well. Let's watch.
Hi, Dr. Stein. Kyle Polinsky here from Secular Talk. I have a question about the drug war. So, in the war on drugs, over 160,000 people died in a literal war against the drug cartels. We've spent over $1 trillion since its launch. And drug use, at the same time, hasn't dropped at all, at all. Now, on top of that, we know that alcohol prohibition made the mafia more powerful. We now know that drug prohibition makes the drug cartels more powerful. And also, a lack of regulation in the drug market, because it's a black market, leads to deaths. For example, Philip Seymour Hoffman with his bad batch of heroin that was laced with fentanyl. That was because of a lack of regulation, because the drug is illegal. So knowing all that, and knowing that somebody gets arrested for drug possession every 25 seconds in America, will you go as far as saying you support legalizing, taxing, and regulating all drugs, not just marijuana, but all drugs, because we know that prohibition doesn't work?
So that's a great question. Across the board, without a doubt, I will definitely instruct the Drug Enforcement Agency to do something really radical, and that is to use science in determining what substances will and won't be listed as scheduled substances. So right off the top, marijuana and cannabis come off. Those are the workhorses of the entire underground drug economy, which basically then pulls the rug out from under this mafioso industry. I think we need to decriminalize drugs and to treat all drugs as a health issue, not as a criminal issue. So I would certainly, be on the same page here in that regard. As far as legalizing, taxing, and regulating all drugs, I think that needs more discussion and more study. But I think we can get 90% of the way to where we need to go, to dismantling this very dangerous industry, to ending this very dangerous drug war, and redirecting our resources where they need to go, through number one, legalizing marijuana, and number two, by essentially ending this outrageous war on drugs and treating drugs as a health issue.
Okay.
Next topic. Edgar Velasquez asks, what specific changes would you make in the healthcare industry that would drive down costs and benefit both patients and healthcare professionals?
We need an improved Medicare for All plan that takes Medicare. It patches in some of the holes that have been knocked into it, like we need to cover pharmaceuticals. We need to be sure that chronic care is covered as well as acute care. And then we need to just immediately drop the age of eligibility to from the point of conception, actually. So you are covered cradle to grave, head to toe, your reproductive health care, your mental health care, every aspect of your care essentially gets covered, and it pays for itself in the savings. Right now, almost $500 billion every year is being paid essentially for pharmaceutical and health insurance industry profiteering. Instead, we put that money into actual health care itself. So this is an easy one. This is a win-win. It's just, let's start doing the right thing that every other developed nation around the world has managed to do. The cost of their care is about half of what we pay. They essentially stabilize the cost of health care, so you don't have this incredible health care inflation that we have. So this is a money saver going into the future, and it doesn't cost us a thing starting now.
Okay, now next, we're going to go to another video. It's Beck Gill. She's also part of the TYT Network on YouTube, and she wanted to follow up on this topic.
Hi, I'm Beck Gill, producer of SciQ on the Young Turks Network. You've talked extensively on your concern about the corporate influence over U.S. vaccine regulations. My question is, what evidence do you have that corporate influence has caused either the FDA or the CDC to make decisions that endanger American children's health?
Okay, actually, my issue is not simply corporate influence over vaccines. It's actually corporate influence over the FDA and all other regulatory bodies. And let me give you a piece of that evidence. Recently, several years back, there was a scandal regarding Vioxx. This was at a time when hundreds of millions of dollars was pouring in from the pharmaceutical industry in the form of lobbying and campaign contributions, because healthcare was being discussed at the time. Anyhow, there was knowledge at the time that Vioxx caused serious cases of heart disease and was actually causing injury in well over 100,000 people who were not being warned about this, and physicians were not being notified about this. The information was being kept secret, essentially, by the FDA study committee, which was going ballistic because they objected to this. This was coming from higher up in the FDA, that the real risks of Vioxx were being suppressed. After about 5 years, finally the truth came out, and people were appropriately warned. But this is a case in point of how the industry tampers with our regulatory agencies. Now, you can also look at the revolving door here. For example, Monsanto, which is supposed to be regulated by the FDA, has been in the very comfortable position of having some of its lobbyists on the highest offices of the FDA. And I don't know about you, but I don't feel good about having a Monsanto lobbyist making decisions about what kind of food is or isn't safe, or that should or should not be labeled.
Now, we're already out of time. I went past. I'm going to do one more question here.
Okay.
I think Sam Cedar has a very good one for you. It's also in video form, so let's watch.
Hi, Sam Cedar from the Majority Report. Dr. Stein, I know that you are running to win the presidency, but there are a lot of people who I know who are contemplating voting for the Green Party because they hope that you will reach 5% and qualify for federal matching funds and then begin to build the Green Party for future elections and across the country. I know there are 100 Green Party officials who have are sitting in elected office now, but also over the past 20 years, the number of statewide officials in the Green Party has actually gone down. What I want to know is, do you have a plan to build the Green Party in off-year, non-election years? And if you could tell us what that plan is.
Wonderful question. Thank you. Yes, there is definitely a plan. And I want to underscore that by most recent polls, we are on the threshold of 5% right now. And you can argue that current polling does not tap unlikely voters who are millennials, who are people of color, who are immigrants. So we could, in fact, be at that threshold or potentially even over that threshold. And if word gets out that we can cancel student debt, we could, you know, massively blow past that threshold. But that 5% number, I think, is a minimum transformative goal, because then not only do we have funding with which to really organize in the next election, it also means if we get to 5% that we are on the ballot in most states, so we can actually hit the ground running in these next presidential elections. But the point he makes about organizing right now for the long haul is exactly, you know, front and center. And it's one of the major reasons that I am running right now. In order to lift up this agenda, which is not just a global agenda, it's not just a national agenda, this is a local agenda as well, about what our jobs are like, about whether our water supplies are going to be ruined by fracking, about whether we are supporting public higher education and moving to free public higher education, which is what we should have. There is so much we can do, not only at the national level, but also at the local and the state level. There's been an enormous fear campaign, you know, certainly since Bush, Nader, Gore, there's been a fear campaign. But what we've learned is that the politics of fear delivers everything we were afraid of. All the reasons we were told you had to vote for the lesser evil, because you didn't want the expanding wars, you didn't want the meltdown of the climate, you didn't want the war on immigrants, you didn't want the endless expansion of the prison industrial state and the security state. That's exactly what we've gotten by allowing our voices to be silenced and to allow the lesser evil to speak for us. In many ways, the lesser evil paves the way to the greater evil, because people stop coming out to vote for lesser evil politicians and parties that are throwing them under the bus, even if someone else could do it worse. People just stop participating in their democracy when it's so clear that it's not for us. So, you know, in my opinion, this is about standing up for what we need right now. For others who can't quite, you know, buy that, you know, I'd say make the most progressive vote you can, and at least register green, contribute green, and then fight very hard for ranked choice voting as your very first action, so that this politics of fear is something we can put behind us and actually begin bringing our moral compass to our democracy. Democracy is not a question of who do we hate the most and who do we fear the most. It's got to be about what is the future that we define for ourselves. So this election is about raising up those local candidates, and I urge you, go to your state Green Party website and find out who's running in your town and support their campaign as well. There are hundreds of candidates for office. Our time has come. I mean, we the people, we deserve a political party that is of, by, and for us. Independent third parties have always led the way, whether it's been in abolition. Remember that the parties of abolition were called spoilers back then. During the effort to abolish slavery, we were called spoilers. The labor movement was led by third parties. The women's movement, throughout our history, transformational change has been led by independent third parties. And in the case of Abraham Lincoln, an independent third party candidate actually rose to power, and that third party became a first party in the course of that election. So our future is there for us to take back in our own hands. Stand up now, like our lives depend on it. Together we are unstoppable. Thank you all for being a part of it.
So, quick programming note for everybody at home and for you guys here. Of course, Young Turks normally is a two-hour show every day, right at this time. So we are going to do another hour when we come back from the break. We're going to have Ben Magwitz, John Idolo, Jimmy Dore all here. We're going to talk about the North Dakota pipeline, Shailene Woodley's arrest there, and her powerful statement afterwards. We're going to talk more about the election.
So, and I want to thank again YouTube Space LA for hosting us here, and I want to thank Young Turks members for making independent media happen, tytnetwork.com/join to be part of independent media. And finally, and most importantly, I want to thank Dr. Jill Stein for coming here and giving us very substantive answers to important questions.
A big thank you to Cenk and to the Young Turks for making real media possible. Thank you.
We'll be right back. This is the wildest, craziest motherfucking race I've ever seen. Let us whisper. Wait a minute! Good night and good luck, everybody.
Rick Santorum and Jeb Bush come up a little bit short.
Please clap. The boy behind me has exited.
Down goes Cruz!
These are the two most unpopular candidates we have ever had in our nation's history.
Jesus Christ, there is significant booze every time Hillary Clinton's name is mentioned. This is amazing.
We're kind of heartened because we've been to many, many Trump events and we've seen some shit.
What happened to your right?
We've been taken away by Obama!
Wow. So wonderfully sad!
Chris Christian looked like he was looking at Donald Trump's hair like it was cotton candy.
You're
fucking, you know about it. Talk to me like that.
Anything can happen on election night on the Young Turks.
Got me a little bit time on this show. What else are you gonna want?
You don't want to miss any of this coverage.
Welcome back to the Young Turks. Right in power panel.
All right.
I hear you. It's a bit of a letdown to go from Jill Stein to Jimmy Dore. See, you see that? Nothing but
Thank
love.
You.
That's what I was trying to...
I don't know if they're booing Jill or Jimmy.
All right, Ben Mankiewicz, Jimmy Dore, John Iadarola with us. We of course, have a lot to get to, so by all means, let's do it. John, boom, go right away.
Wow, that's the fastest answer ever. Okay. Keith Kilbert of Indiana is a man who was wrongfully convicted of an armed robbery back in the 90s, and decades later, he is still fighting for something approaching justice in his life. He was originally sentenced in 1997 for a robbery committed in Elkhart, Indiana. Still has a felony on his record despite being a free man. He served 10 years in prison before his conviction was overturned, again, for a crime that he did not commit. Now, over time, as he was in jail, more and more evidence came out to show that he was not actually the man who did it. Back in 2005, an Indiana Court of Appeals overturned the conviction of Cooper's co-defendant. Cooper was given a choice, a new trial before the same judge that convicted him, or go free, but with a felony on his record, a record that continues to contain that felony. Now, some of what's happened in the meantime, in 2014, Indiana's parole board and the prosecutor on the case unanimously recommended that Mike Pence, governor of Indiana, who you might have heard of, he's been hanging out a lot with Donald Trump lately, unanimously recommended that Pence pardon him. Pence refused. Now, the deputy prosecutor originally involved in the actual case with Keith said, Dear Governor Pence, in a letter, I am the former deputy prosecuting attorney that prosecuted Keith Cooper in the Elkhart County Circuit Court. I am writing to you in support of Mr. Cooper's petition for a pardon. So you have the parole board, you have one of the prosecutors involved in the case originally. He went on to say, we cannot undo the wrongful imprisonment of Mr. Cooper, obviously, but we can undo his wrongful conviction with a pardon. And so now, he spent 10 years in prison. He's been fighting for years to get the felony taken off his record, a felony that everybody understands at this point he did not commit. Governor Pence told Cooper he should request a new trial and exhaust all of his legal options before requesting a pardon. Now understand that, again, Keith Cooper didn't do this. Also understand Mike Pence has pardoned three people with felony convictions who admitted guilt during his time as governor. So maybe Keith would have had a better chance if he had actually done the crime.
Yeah, and there's no, just to be clear, no question he didn't do the crime. They got the DNA
evidence.
They have the guy. It's a different guy who did it. What strikes me most about the story, Mike Pence is a bad guy. Mike Pence might be a worse guy than Donald Trump. Mike Pence wanted in 2001 to redirect money for HIV/AIDS research and treatment of people to gay conversion therapy. Mike Pence is a despicable person. So Mike Pence's behavior here doesn't surprise me. I don't know. It seems like a freebie. It seems like a layup that you're not taking. But what strikes me most about this is that moment. And I guess, when was it, John? 2007, when he's given the option.
Mm.
Like, they've already freed his co-defendant. So they're saying, admit guilt, and you can go free, or you can go for a new trial. If they allow him to go free, they know whoever was prosecuting it then, but they don't want that on their record. They don't want the precedent of letting somebody go free. So they're like, we'll let you out of prison. You can walk out of here today, but you're going to have to admit guilt, which will let us feel better, even though we... No, you didn't do it. That, to me, that's that, you know, we talk about wanting to arrest people on Wall Street and so forth. That seems criminal to me, that kind of behavior, to not say, wow, Keith Cooper, you're free today. No matter what, you walk out of here. If you want a new trial, fine, but you're free. And making him say he was guilty to a crime he didn't commit to save face is disgusting.
Yeah. Well, Ben, I don't think you're being fair to Mike Pence. I think that what might be worse than the gay conversion therapy is when he wanted to force women who had an abortion or a miscarriage to do a funeral for their fetus.
Didn't just want it, he signed that law.
Yeah, and so, yes, he's a legendarily bad guy if people knew enough about him. But look at this, in the middle of a presidential run, when you know the guy is innocent, it's amazing. How hard is it? We and Mike Pence knows. It's not like Mike Pence doesn't know, he knows. Everybody knows the parole board never says, hey, pardon the guy. They might parole people, etc., but it's a very rare thing for them to say, yo, governor, over here, this guy's super innocent. For Christ's sake, in the middle of a red state, make sure you pardon him.
Yeah.
And Pence is like, nope, not going to do it.
Not going to do it. I'm running for president, and I need to see, or vice president, or maybe eventually president after Trump gets impeached, if that were to happen. Anyway, no, I'm not going to do it because I need to seem more barbaric.
You know, Jake, Mike Pence is even more disgusting than that. while he was doing all that stuff, I saw a picture of him one time putting ketchup on a steak while wearing Crocs.
Oh, my goodness. Well, you know, in Indiana, though, they're like that. You know, he has a nickname in Indiana, you know? It's Mike. That was from the convention
when
they said that. But that's not a nickname, that's his name.
That's what they call him back home.
Back home, Mike.
Sure. So also, I didn't make clear, like, this isn't just about clearing his name. I mean, there's a human cost to this. So he has that on his record, and that has employment consequences. He's out there, he's been doing the same job for almost 10 years now. He wants to move up in the ranks, but there are some jobs that if you have a felony on your record, you can't actually get, even if the people at his job understand that he didn't actually do it. We see, this is one of the, I mean, we talk on the show a lot about the various ways that the Justice Department is, to use a term that's been popular recently, rigged against the regular person, but it's where politics intrudes on what should be. It seems, I think, to anyone in the audience right now, a common sense thing. You explain what happened, it's taken off of his record. But when you put it for someone like Mike Pence to even have a say in the matter, well, he's trying to appeal to absolutely crazy people on his side, and so what do you expect the result to be? And so people get held by, like, for instance, can he vote at this point? I assume that he cannot. And so what he's asking for is to simply have a slightly better chance at moving up within his job. Now, unfortunately, the justice for Keith will never go beyond that because Indiana is one of the 20 states in this country that has no laws allowing for compensation for people who've been wrongfully imprisoned. You should get millions and millions of dollars for a full decade of your life being robbed from you.
It's almost like Indiana has a history of racism or something.
I'm going to guess those three people that he did pardon who admitted guilt, white?
I don't know, but I think we should look into it.
We should look at
it. That's a good chance.
Okay.
Yeah. Look, let's just, last two things here to focus on. John makes a good point. It's also on the voters. I mean, if you're a conservative, do you want people who are innocent to be punished? Is that a thing? You conservatives, do you feel good at night going to sleep thinking, I'm a good Christian, I punished that innocent guy. I rewarded the politician who wouldn't let him off knowing that he's free, knowing that he didn't do it. And again, he's out, he's not in prison anymore, but won't take it off his record, right? Does that make you feel better for the guy? Does that make you feel like, yeah, Mike Pence is my guy. He will not do justice.
Also, just like, yeah, I mean, and first of all, we know from many other cases the number of times prosecutors won't walk back a conviction once they know it's wrong. It happens, it doesn't just happen in Indiana, it happens across the country. There is an unwillingness to admit that justice was not served in a prior case. Frequently, I've now gotten to the point where I'm always amazed when a prosecutor does this, when somebody says, interesting that he's, I bet, no longer there.
I don't know. I mean, not in that same
position. Position. So there's such a hesitancy to do it. But Mike Pence doesn't have to have a press conference about it. Just sign it. Go on campaigning. Just get it over with. Just do it. Just get it over with. Just do it. Take you 10 seconds.
Yeah. So because Democratic voters don't have much say here because, you know, it's a red state. Now, they could have plenty of say if they had a Democratic governor, and that's not impossible in Indiana.
No,
but
I think they're about to have
one. Yeah, that's right. So you'll have plenty of say in a little bit, right? But more importantly here, Republican voters, is this what you want to reward? Or do you want to say, hey, wait, don't do injustice on my name, on my behalf, just because you think that's going to make me happy? I'm not a fan of injustice either. And then secondly, I just wanted to point out, this is sometimes bipartisan. Bill Clinton interrupted his primary fight when he was in 92, when he was running for president, to go back home to Arkansas to execute a guy who a lot of people thought was mentally not competent. And he bragged about it. And that was a hell of a thing to do, and not a hell of a thing to do in a positive way. And so I'm saying to all voters, stop rewarding that kind of behavior. Yeah.
Well, I guess it's through the law and order. I mean, Trump keeps saying we're law and order. So maybe, some crazy way they would see, like, oh, this is me showing a vulnerability that I'm going to let this guy go because he's black and we all know he did something.
Yeah.
Yeah, and remember, by the way, it was only a couple of weeks ago that Donald Trump, the Central Park 5 case was brought up again. Oh. It was made clear they didn't actually do it. Do you think that they did it? Yes, I still think that they did it.
I mean,
and that's both his flaw psychologically, but obviously Republicans look out there and they see enough voters who refuse to accept any backtracking, any changing your mind, any evolution of what you think. And so they respond to it. And so, to some extent, we're responsible for the way our politicians act. If we tell them, if you ever change your mind, if you ever take in evidence and adapt based on that, that we're going to think that you're weak or spineless or something like that, then they're not going to change their mind when the evidence changes. And that's not a good place for the political system.
Real quick, poll in Indiana today, the Democrat is up 5 points today in Indiana to be the governor. Obviously, Pence not running for re-election, so there might be a Democratic governor. I'm sure he's a real progressive.
Yeah, and I just want to double up on John and Jimmy's points, which is, look, in this situation here, we can't go around and just, Jimmy made the point that it might be racial, right? So there might be some people at home who are like, hey, don't bring race into it, yada, yada. You don't know that it's racially motivated, etc. But John's point about the Central Park 5 is fairly dispositive.
Yeah,
I mean,
right.
Here's a case where, again, DNA evidence, wrongly convicted. In the state of New York, actually, they can get compensation. They did. They got a lot of compensation. The state of New York saying, we're so sorry. We had the wrong people. There's a guy who confessed to it. DNA connected to be the actual rapist in that case. And Trump still says, no, I want them punished. Well, then, if it's not about the guilt, and it's not about justice, and it's not about law and order, because law and order would punish the other guy, right? Then maybe it is about the race.
Yeah.
And so here we are with his VP saying, no, I can't let, pardon this guy who also happens to be black. And then you wonder, is it about the race?
We don't know the other three cases. And my hunch is they're not all white. That would be too perfect. Like, it can't be. Stories don't work that way. But Pence's press secretary... I did Google it. I don't have it. You guys can keep checking. Pence's press secretary said neither race nor politics played any role.
Oh, well, then there you go. Sorry. My bad.
Yeah.
My bad.
Ooh, oh, yeah. I'm sorry, John, you know, I didn't mention that at the top.
I denounced myself. I was wrong. Making me look like a fool. Anyway. Okay, why don't we switch it up and talk about something?
Yeah, we can. And in the transition, I should say that I always find these high chairs to be enormously uncomfortable.
Yeah, it's like
it's so awkward. Who sits like this at home, right? Like,
I don't know.
I do.
You do?
Yeah. I did an interview with the directors of Jesus Camp. Some of you probably saw Jesus Camp.
Oh, yeah.
Nominated.
Yeah.
I lost Al Gore's documentary. And they have a new documentary. It's Norman Lear, who I think book you're still reading. And we had them in the director's chair, and one of them was wearing a dress, not like it, just a normal dress. And she was like, who puts a woman in a director's chair in front of an audience?
That's funny. I forget who it was. It was Susan Sarandon or someone who was making the same point. I thought maybe when we were interviewing them, like, director's chairs were made for men.
Yeah, we're made for men, and men don't even like
it. Wait a minute.
That's right.
Yeah, men don't like
Your question is, who puts a woman in a dress in a director's chair?
Yeah.
Roger Ailes.
Yeah.
Or Donald Trump.
Okay.
But not together anymore. Okay.
By the way, just real quick before we move on, because we're talking about Trump, they're starting that TV network, and there's two new shows coming out.
Yeah.
And the first show is on the Trump network, Who Wants to Be a Millionaire Who Never Pays Taxes?
That'll be good.
And Law and Order Special Trump Victims Unit. One more, How I Met Your Mother While Cheating on My Wife.
Okay, let's switch it up. The new fundraising numbers have come out for the presidential election, and they are good news for Hillary Clinton, but not good news for those of us who don't want our political elections to be determined by hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars. In total, Clinton and her allies have raised a total of $869 million entering October. So you still got a month and a little bit more to pad that number. Trump, meanwhile, has amassed $599 million, which is not as much. Still a lot of money for a one-man
suit. It seems like it's
lately
until May. That's a good number for not having started until May.
We're going to break it down a little bit more. Let's bring up this chart here. Hopefully people will be able to see it. And you see that it includes both the campaign's direct the money that they've brought in, but then also affiliated super PACs, the DNC and the RNC and all of that. And this candidate has faced such a large disparity in fundraising and won in the modern political era. There you're seeing what we were talking about a little bit earlier. Just huge amounts of money. The political party, obviously, a big chunk of it. Especially in the case of Donald Trump, it looks almost even there. I wasn't going to use the rest of it. Anyway. But yes, so no candidate has faced such a large disparity and won in the modern political era. Because, and I looked into this, how much money you raise and how much your policies would benefit the public have a perfect correlation.
Yeah.
That's why you have to. Yeah.
Yeah. And keep in mind that Trump has done this. Trump is at $600 million, and we know why he hasn't raised it as much, in part because he's a hideous monster. But the Koch brothers were planning to give so much money to the, they were talking about spending maybe $800 million.
Like the exact amount Hillary Clinton raised. So about $900 million the Koch brothers alone were going to spend.
Yeah, yes. And they spent some of it in the beginning on other candidates, and then they ended up, they're sitting it out.
Well,
yeah.
So they're gonna spend some of it on the congressional races.
Yes. Yeah.
But they're not giving any to Trump, so that's a giant chunk that he's missing.
And Sheldon Adelson just parted ways with Trump.
Oh, is that right?
Today, JR.
Oh, today?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Because he'd already given $10 million at a minimum to Trump.
Exactly.
And so, look, he's missing some big donors. But look at the perverse system that we have, where they're like, oh, Trump didn't get the Koch brothers to give him a couple hundred million dollars that he would have, any other Republican candidate would have normally gotten. Now, do you think they're going to want anything back for that couple hundred million dollars? Or they're doing it out of the goodness of their heart? No, they got a sense that, hey, this guy's not going to be good for our business. Another guy we would have given money to was going to be good for our business.
Yeah.
And so they didn't give it.
But why do you want to stop the Kochs from speaking 800 million times?
So, look, the Koch brothers not involved directly with him, but let's talk about some of the billionaires who might want something after this election. We're going to start with Hillary Clinton. Priorities USA Action, now supporting Clinton, has raised $158 million. Which, by the way, if you just went, let's say, I have more. Let's say you went around the world and you told a random person in some other system, not dominated by money, did you know that in the entire election, both the candidates raised $158 million? They'd say that's a crazy amount of money. That's just Priorities USA Action Fund. One little super PAC raising what should be more than we spend in all the elections altogether. It received $1 million checks from hedge fund billionaire David Shaw, savings and loan billionaire Herb Sandler, philanthropist Marsha Loffer, and Allied Wallet founder Ahmad Khawaja.
Oh, he's an ally.
He's an ally. Yeah, and those are...
He's an ally to their wallet.
Well, here's a guy, you can make millions of dollars selling wallets? Like,
I don't know,
a billionaire?
It's probably a digital
thing. How much are those wallets?
But think about it, an individual handing over $1 million.
Genuine leather.
You know, probably.
Right.
Yeah. 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 You buy it for a lifetime, really.
You probably got like a clear slot for your license and then a place for your credit cards.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's no way you don't make $1 billion without having a clear slot.
You have a wallet?
I do have a wallet.
You have a wallet?
It's not
a
wallet.
Yeah, mine has a little space for a spare key, so if I lose my wallet, people will not only have my address,
right, sure,
but they'll be able to get right into my house.
There you go. We all have wallets, so I can see where that was.
Okay, so let's break this down.
That's a lot of money.
Yeah. So there's a couple of issues with this story. So number one, before we get into the giant amount of money in politics, which we've already gotten into to a large degree, but there's even more, there is a political side of this, an electoral part of it that's important. So the money buys you certain things. A lot of times it buys you media. It buys you television commercials. Gee, I wonder why TV doesn't talk about money in politics, because it goes mainly to them, right? But the other thing that it buys is staffers. And that's why Donald Trump, he's not self-financing. He sometimes says that it's not true. He did go beg donors for money. He did make promises to them. In fact, the Mercers, who are his larger donors, Robert Mercer and Rebecca Mercer, pretty much got to run his campaign. In fact, one of the good government groups that went after Hillary Clinton for some of her coordination with super PACs also went after Donald Trump and said, you basically allowed these donors to run your campaign. Your campaign manager and your campaign CEO used to work for them. Now they work for you. It's obvious that they bought you lock, stock, and barrel, which is entirely true. But in his incompetence in raising the money, he hurt himself, right? Because right now, for example, in the 11 states where the Democratic state parties raised money, they have 3,011 swing states. These are the critical states, unfortunately, the only states that matter for the presidential election. The Democrats have 3,536 staffers.
in the 11 swing states.
In the 11 swing states. The Republicans only have 1,028. So the Democrats have more than tripled the staffers on the ground who can get out the vote, who can motivate their voters, do the important hard work of getting elected. So that, I told you, one of the reasons Donald Trump would lose is because of his incompetence. So there it is. Now, on the other hand, I don't want to applaud Hillary Clinton for going and getting, honestly, legally bribed to the tune of, apparently, in the end, about $1 billion. That is not something to be applauded. I understand that in this system, she's going to beat Donald Trump, yada, yada. At the same time, if you're going to do that, you should, at a very minimum, say, hey, next time we're going to have free and fair elections. Next time, I'm not going to take big money. I'm not going to take corporate money. So I promise to you that within 4 years, we're going to get money out of politics. Otherwise, I'm going to have to run without corporate money and big money. But she's not doing anything of that sort. And if you read the WikiLeaks documents, she's in favor of business as usual. She doesn't have a problem with this system. She has gained greatly from this system. And it looks like she'll be president because of this system. Well, and we should all have a problem with that, not based on what we think of Hillary Clinton's policies, but based on the idea that we are allowing those billionaires that John just mentioned to buy our politicians, whether they're Democrats or Republicans. That is not a democracy.
And I, you know, I don't have the nearly the problem with Hillary Clinton that some progressives do, but I get that under this system, eventually I will. You know, I mean, at some point, there'll be someone who everybody objects to. And so let's stop it now before we get to that point.
Yeah, and what you said about with the WikiLeaks about what she actually thinks about all this, and we were happy when she mentioned getting rid of Citizens United during the debate, but I'm almost sick of hearing about Citizens United, because it seems like if that is being held up as the goal, that seems like such a huge dodge. It seems like a way to fool people into thinking that if only we can reverse Citizens United, then everything is going to be fixed. No, we'll be back to the status quo.
2008.
Yeah,
when money had no impact on politics. Impact on politics.
Exactly. And it's almost, it's to the point where sometimes when you give people information, you can do it to educate, but you can also do it to cause them to not see the underlying problem. The underlying problem is that Citizens United is step one of 15 that we need to do. To get back to where we were in the 60s, maybe, someday, if we're lucky.
Yeah, and real quick, Jill Stein was just here doing a town hall with us, and she made a very good point about Hillary Clinton's position on this. Hillary Clinton keeps emphasizing, and it's true, I just reread the transcript of the third debate because I'm a dork, and in it she talks about unaccountable money. She mentions that all the time. Well, how about quote-unquote accountable money? Unaccountable money means dark money, and we don't know where it's coming from. So she says that kind of bribery is wrong. But accountable money, where I say, yeah, that billionaire gave me all the money, is right. That's not right. No. That's still bribery. It's just a bribery that we know about.
Yeah. So it all started, and so what's the consequence of Democrats taking money like Republicans? Well, it started with Bill Clinton, and he gutted welfare, did the Telecommunications Act. We have six companies controlling all the news now. He passed NAFTA. He deregulated Wall Street. And finally, when Barack Obama was running for president, he got more money from Wall Street than the Republicans. And right now, Hillary Clinton has twice as many $100,000 butlers as Barack Obama did. So it's getting way worse.
Okay, on that cheery note, we had that segment. Okay, you know what? We're going to blow past the break. You sure we keep going?
Oh, no,
keep going! Yeah! All right.
Okay. So let's do the other two stories.
Yeah.
There's a guy out here. That's one of my favorite buttons I've ever seen. He's got a button that just says flag pin.
I like that. That way, he's still patriotic.
Totally,
still patriotic. I was starting to question.
And he gets to stick it to the man a little at the same time.
You know what? You know when the Young Turks anthem was playing, he was sitting. I don't know. That's and there's a flag there. You're still sitting. Kind of fishy.
Okay. Potentially scary story for you. The U.S. Border Patrol. There's a new plan that's about to go into effect for the U.S. government for foreign nationals that are trying to come into the U.S. From countries around the world where we have sort of visa waiver programs, basically the states like in Europe, for instance, where we have a little bit of an easier path for people to come into the U.S. And what they want to do now is start to gather information on those people's social media activity. Now, they're saying that it's optional. But we know where that can go after a little bit, after you give that sort of power to the government. And a lot of privacy advocates are worried about where this could potentially end, including privacy advocates at the UN who've sent letters trying to stop them from putting this program into effect. Now, some limitations have been put onto the program in the past 6 months of debate, but we are very close to it actually going into effect now. So the U.S. Customs and Border Protection wants to start collecting information associated with your online presence, including your provider slash platform and social media identifier, which for a lot of people is going to mean your Twitter handle in particular. They can try to get information from your Facebook, but a lot of people thankfully have wised up and made that private. Twitter, on the other hand, a lot of people have information accessible on that. But there are a lot of concerns, including that it appears that even if a friend or associate has not directly interacted with the applicant on social media, the agency will ferret out connections from the person applying to people who can be one or two steps removed from them on social media. This is what's called contact chaining or two-hop analysis, where they don't just look into you, and they don't even theoretically just look into your contacts, they look into your contacts' contacts for anything that could be suspicious. And if a follower of an applicant raises a red flag to the agency, the applicant may be denied permission to travel to the U.S.
Well, I'm definitely against it, because if they look into my contacts, they're going to find Jimmy Dore.
And if they look at my contacts, I'm going to tell them I wear glasses.
And you guys are all screwed, because you've got me as a contact, and I've got family members who are Muslim. You're all Muslim. You're all family of the country. You're done, especially under Trump. So
I don't follow you.
That's right. You're smart. Yeah. Smart thinking. So, look, problem number one, let me break it down this way. Look, I get why people who are trying to fight terrorists want this, right? Because it's not incorrect that sometimes that people will leave clues on social media. Because people who do crimes, whether it's terrorism or bank robbery, are usually knuckleheads. So, yeah. You know, we've done the stories, the guys who go on Facebook after they rob someone, they're like, hey, this is Bob's money, right? And then they get caught. And then we've seen sometimes, I think with the San Bernardino shooters, that they had left some notes on social media.
Yeah.
So it's not like there's no value in that. I understand it. Now, it's incumbent upon someone to weigh things out, though, because there's also a great disadvantage. The disadvantage is, okay, now it's an obvious gross violation of privacy that everyone entering the country, all right, give me all your social media. Not only do I want to know everything you've tweeted, everything you put on Facebook, every little nook and cranny of your life, but then I'm going to get into the people you know, and maybe you barely know. You remember the guy from high school that you think you remember, that you friended on Facebook, but you're not even positive, and he does something wrong? Well, how am I responsible for that guy?
Just think about it this way, in the most simplest terms. I'm sure we all do. Like, I follow some conservatives to see what they're saying. Right?
That's right.
So imagine if you're from somewhere else in the world, and you follow a couple of perhaps even all fanatics because you want to see what they're saying, how people are responding to it, because you want to be up on the news. And it's literally nothing more than that.
Yeah. But you just gave me an upside to this law, that if they ever come for me, they will accidentally arrest all of our trolls.
Oh, yeah. The other.
Yes? Who are our number one followers.
Totally. That's right, yeah.
So let me expand the conversation a little bit, because obviously the core of the idea why they say they're doing it is to stop terrorists from entering the country, and obviously we don't want terrorists to enter the country. But we also know that when you give the government an avenue to gather information, it could go a lot farther than its initial parameters. So I'm going to jump ahead. I apologize to those in the control room. This is from the Electric Frontier Foundation, which is a group that worries about both privacy and civil liberty.
I have all their albums going.
They're great, yeah. Social media handles can easily lead the government to information about a traveler's political leanings, true, but also religious affiliations, reading habits, purchase histories, dating preferences, sexual orientation, among other things. Moreover, given the highly networked nature of social media, the government would also learn such personal details about travelers' family members, friends, professional colleagues, and other innocent associates, many of whom may be U.S. citizens and or residents with constitutional and statutory rights. Because if you're entering from another country into the U.S., you might well know some people in the U.S., and now the government has the directive to go in and find out about those people. And what have you posted on your Facebook and on your Twitter and maybe on your wish list on Amazon and all of that?
Yeah.
Maybe on Reddit, maybe on 4chan. We can reconstruct who you are as a person down to the cellular level based on some people's social media activity.
Yeah, I have a feeling that this is an unstoppable reality, that, you know, as we live in this again, with, as we put ourselves out there in social media, the extent that we do, especially for people outside the country without the same rights inside the country that we do, that the government is just tracking it all the time. And that I don't know that I don't know how we go about.
Well, okay, so that's what I was going to say, though. You need someone in charge to say, no, we are not going to do that.
Yeah.
I'm weighing these two things. I understand the value of the people who are tracking the bad guys, and I understand the downside of the privacy, gross privacy violations, and I say no in the balance. And if someone doesn't draw the line like that, yes, they will encroach into our privacy more and more until they know every single thing about us. And there we are, a frog in slowly boiling water with our rights and our privacy taken from us by Big Brother. That's how Big Brother happens.
It already happened, right? Did it already happen?
Yeah, we had this fight in
a different state already. So is this, now Johnny, let me ask you, this is just for people, foreigners coming in, or anybody who leaves the country and comes back?
So right now, this is specifically for people coming in from countries that have visa waiver programs, like in predominantly in Europe. Those foreign nationals trying to come in and visit the U.S.
Oh, okay. So not citizens.
Not yet. But again, by going to those people's networks, if you do the two hop thing, you can vacuum up a whole lot of citizens in that.
And Jimmy, keep in mind, those are some dangerous Europeans we're talking about.
Yeah, the bad hombres.
Yeah. All right, we're going to run out of time. Let's do the Shailene Woodley story as quickly as humanly possible.
Okay, I will read fast because I couldn't really cut out too much of what she said. All right, but I will try to be fast. Actress and activist Shailene Woodley was arrested last week while protesting the construction of the Dakota Access Pipeline alongside over 200 other water protectors. And now she's out and she's written an editorial about her experience and what for her the struggle represents, but also for those who have been there for months and continue to be there, like Shailene. So first of all, she wanted to talk about the fact that in this country, we obviously have a tragic history going back with the relationship between the federal government and various Native communities. And now it's one of the groups in our country that you're simply allowed to take their culture and just use it for whatever you want in a light and shallow way without understanding what it really represents. And she's been witnessing that as well. She says, "We wear their heritage, their sacred totems as decoration and in fashion trends, failing to honor their culture, headdresses, feathers, arrows, moccasins, sage, beadwork. You know what I'm talking about, Coachella. Walking around the flea market this weekend, I can't even tell you how many Native references I saw being used in a way that feeds our Western narrative." And then she talks about the government consequences of this, the policy consequences. "When we talk about marginalized communities in our country, we do not, on a mainstream level, include Native Americans. When we talk about sex trafficking in our country, we do not, on a mainstream level, include Native Americans. When we talk about government integrity, we do not, on a mainstream level, include Native Americans. Treaties are broken, land is stolen, dams are built, reservations are flooded, people are displaced. Yet we fail to notice, we fail to acknowledge, we fail to act." And one of the reasons she wanted to get arrested for, she goes into in this. "So much so that it took me, a white, non-Native woman, being arrested on October 10th in North Dakota on Indigenous Peoples Day to bring this cause to many people's attention and to the forefront of news publications around the world. The day I was detained, 26 others had to dress in orange as well, as they were booked into the Morton County Jail. Did you hear about them?" And then she says, and she's obviously happy that people were rallying around her, and we did a video right after it happened, "But what if we took the hashtag Free Shailene and made it hashtag Protect Clean Water, or hashtag Honor Native Treaties, or hashtag I Stand with Standing Rock? What if we don't let this stop trending on social media, at our dinner tables, in the streets? What if we wake up to the possibilities of noticing, of choosing, and of acting on our awareness? Will you choose money, or will you choose children? Will you choose ignorance, or will you choose love? Will you choose blindness, or will you choose freedom?" And she continues to support that community on the ground protesting against the construction.
Let me just say something quickly, because on my other job, I'm host of Turner Classic Movies, and especially in this election season, we've done some election movies, and Turner Classic Movies is not the place to air one's political beliefs. Nobody there, I think, has an ID. They know where I stand. But whenever politics bleeds into anything, I get grief on Twitter. Shut up, these are not for politics. There's a rich history of Hollywood activism and a relevant history and an important history. And Shailene Woodley is literally the best Hollywood has to offer. She's really the best America has to offer, and she happens to also be an important and relevant and rising Hollywood actress. And it's just great to see. You know, you go back to the 1940s and you look at the those in Hollywood who stood against the blacklist and who stood against McCarthyism, and they led that fight. And so to see somebody who is bonus, it's inspiring. Like, it makes me feel good about that, you know, spending a career talking about movies can be a little more substantive than sometimes it seems to be. So I'm, you know, she doesn't need me to be proud of her, but I'm enormously proud that she's representative of this business.
Yeah. Yeah, I think on the activism front, we have yet begun to fight. This is the tip of the iceberg. I think in the next 4 years, the iceberg is coming. And so people like Shailene Woodley make a big difference, and the reason they do is because people pay attention to it, and we wish that they would pay attention to the 26 others that were arrested, as she says in her editorial, but oftentimes they don't. So that is why people get so mad, people who don't want you paying attention, when Shailene Woodley does it, when Rosario Dawson does it to get money out of politics, when Colin Kaepernick does it about Black Lives Matter. People get so upset because they're like, oh no, this will cause people to pay attention to it. Okay, and so the reality is that's a wonderful thing. It's a courageous thing for them to do, and I think that we're going to see a lot more of it, and we're going to stop listening to those naysayers who said, oh no, 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 don't you dare voice your opinions. Don't you dare try to protect others. I think that Shailene's courage is going to echo for a long time going forward.
And then, you know, and that's why it's a really nice thing, even though he won't take a call from Sweden, why a guy like Bob Dylan got the Nobel Prize. Bob Dylan has been talking about it for a long time, and so it matters, and God bless these people for doing it. Again, yes, we shouldn't care more what George Clooney thinks than anybody, than any of those other 26 people. But we pay attention. So good for him for speaking out, and mostly this is about her. Good for her.
Yeah. Well, just real quick, we live in a world where we already are considering people who are protesting as terrorists, and journalists are being jailed. And the executive branch is using extreme measures to jail journalists. We're living in a scarier time than I think people realize. And I think we are closer to the iceberg than people realize, too. I hope we are.
It's not just as we go forward, and many of you, as I will, I hope, be thoroughly enjoying the World Series, which begins Tuesday. One of the teams playing it is the Cleveland Indians, who I might well be rooting for, because the Cleveland, well, now Cleveland, all they do is win. But, you know, they got this insane mascot, this smiling Indian Chief Wahoo. Like that's just, you know, that stuff's got to go. The Washington Redskins team name, it's got to go. It's long overdue. And more importantly than that, I think, even, is this very comfortable appropriation we have, I mean, with the Tomahawk missiles and Chinook helicopters and all these weapons of war that we have now decided, Apache helicopters. We've just appropriated Native American names, turned them into our weapons of war that we use to kill other people who we've taken advantage of across the world, and some who we haven't taken advantage of. And we feel comfortable with that. And I guarantee you, we didn't check with the Apache Nation when we went ahead and decided to name our helicopters Apache helicopters.
Yeah.
Like, let's just cut it out. Let's think of another name. Call it Dave, the Dave helicopter. Take it into battle.
Right. Well, look, the fight against the war machine, that is also coming. That iceberg is also coming. So I think it's a good step forward, and I think we're going to see a lot more civil disobedience as Americans are fed up with all this. I want to thank everybody who came here today, guys, as we're way out of time. I want to thank everybody at home, of course. Most especially, as we always do, I want to thank our members for being able to put something like this together. I hope that you learned something from the Jill Stein Town Hall that we did. And again, without our members, we wouldn't have been able to do that. We wouldn't be in the independent media that we are. TYTnetwork.com/join to become a member. Everybody check out John on Monday on the Young Turks on Fusion. He's going to be interviewing David Axelrod about whether Obama and Hillary Clinton are real progressives, and so will Anna Kasparian. And, of course, we'll be back on Monday as well. Thank you, and bye-bye.